Hello, Sophie here. So I've been experimenting with ways to blend colors together to get smooth transitions with grease pencil pretty much ever since I started using this amazing tool. Gradient fills can be very effective to blend two colors along a straight line or in a circle, although the edges of the gradient strokes will still be a hard edge. The airbrush tool used with a dots type material is really impressive. On my end, I'm just noticing a bit of discoloring, especially for larger strokes that I'm not quite sure how to get rid of. Another way is to get a bit more creative about blending and getting smooth transitions. So one of my favorite techniques is to use a lot of textures in my work to give the illusion of soft edges, so blending with textures. And this artwork was actually created using only a brush at 100% opacity, trying to create the illusion of soft edges by just painting a bunch of in-between colors. This is actually something I do a lot for practice. It's quite fun. Honestly, I just like exploring different options and possibilities because you never know where they'll lead or how they'll come in handy. And so what I want to share in this video is a method of creating a pixel canvas to get smooth color transitions. A pixel canvas in a vector painting program. I know. Before you ask, why don't you just use a pixel program? I made this video all about why I love working with grease pencil. The fact that it's a vector program is honestly so powerful and useful for me. So what I'm doing here is trying to combine the benefits of a pixel canvas with the benefits of a vector program and sneak peek at a future video topic. I can even turn this into a 3D pixel canvas and combine this with Blender's 3D capabilities. Amazing. But let's go back to the start, a new 2D animation workspace. I'll first make my canvas a square, 1000 by 1000 pixels. And I'll lower the resolution percentage to 25%. Now I'll come here into the rendering workspace, F12 to render, and I have created a 250 by 250 pixel image. Save this image, and then I'll slide into a new workspace over here and open up this image. I do this because the setting I want is in this dropdown at the bottom here, and you can see it's grayed out for the render result. But when I open up the image file, it's available and I can press on Generate Grease Pencil. Back in my 2D animation workspace, I can see the object that got created, and I'll make the statistics visible to show you that it contains 250 strokes and 62,500 pixels or points. This is, of course, 250 squared because this is our grease pencil pixel canvas of 250 pixels squared. Why? Why are we doing this? And now in edit mode, here is a look at all of these points. In vertex paint mode, the draw tool has now become our vehicle to smooth color transitions, multiple gradients, and a rainbow of soft edges. I'm using a drawing tablet here with pen pressure, which helps. And I still lower the brush strength and I'm pressing really, really lightly with a large brush radius. The major drawback to this method, in my opinion, is the huge amount of geometry it requires. From experience, past maybe 200,000 points, my laptop becomes too slow to handle my blend files. So that's what, like a pixel canvas of just under 450 pixels? 450 would be like unthinkably small for painting in a pixel program, unless you're making pixel art, of course, but I am not. I will say, grease pencil being vector-based seems to do a pretty good job in general scaling up this canvas. For the most part, it doesn't get pixelated. So remember, this rainbow was painted from our 250 square canvas, and here I have scaled it up to 2,500 square pixels. And looking at it, zooming in, I can't even tell that this was painted at a low resolution. So I do have an interest in using this pixel canvas in a way that it's going to have the most impact. Otherwise, it's a lot of geometry for not very much. So for this portrait I want to paint, getting to have smooth transitions in the face would be really helpful. It's an area of great interest, so having more geometry in the face will allow me to get more subtleties in the skin. So beneath my sketch layer, I'll create a new layer for the face, and I'm using a material that just has a fill, with a solid style and an alpha value of 1. And I'll be using this to fill in the shape of the face. Like we saw with the first canvas, color does not matter at this point. It can be completely changed later on. But I don't know. I'll still pick a color that makes sense to me for the skin. I tend to use the push tool in sculpt mode to tweak the fill shape a little bit more. Typically, I'd rather overshoot the areas I want to fill rather than not fill them enough, because it's easier later on to delete those points that go past where I want them to. So with this area filled, I can hide the other layers. Then in render properties, I'll open up film and check the box for transparent. Then I want to render as a PNG RGBA. So this will render only this fill shape and create an image file with a transparent background around this fill. I won't pretend that I can estimate how many pixels this random shape will be. Instead, I do a bit of trial and error here. So I've rendered it and I'll just see what kind of point count this gives me when I generate grease pencil. I will say, if there's a delay of more than 1 or 2 seconds after I click generate grease pencil, it's pretty safe to say that it was too big. Let me check. That is indeed more than 200,000 pixels. And given that this is not even the only pixel canvas I want to create, nah, that is too big. So here's where the trial and error comes in. Initially, what I did is I would render multiple versions at different resolutions, scaling it down and down, saving those different images, and just opening them up one at a time. But I realized that there's a resize setting directly in the image editor in Blender. I can just use this, scale the image down and down, test out different resolutions and point counts until I'm left with something that I feel that I can work with. This looks good, I would say. However, this new object is popping up a bit all over the canvas and it isn't in line with our original object. So the easiest way that I found to line them up is to use the 3D cursor. First, I have to make it visible. That is this here in the overlays. So I want to place the 3D cursor as much as possible in line with this bottom left-hand corner as I can. And then I basically just select my initial object, right-click, and set the origin to the 3D cursor. So the art of this object didn't move. But the little orange dot of the origin is now here at the 3D cursor. And now the pixel canvas that I generate will also start from here. First, I need to go into object mode because I start in edit mode of this new object. And then in the scene collection, I want to select my initial grease pencil object, control select the new object. And in the layers dropdown, I want to copy layer to selected. Now I'll delete this new object to save on points. So here I select my original object. I lowered the opacity of my first fill layer just so this next part is going to be easier to see. Then I selected this new layer that got created. It's called image layer in edit mode. I use a setting in the grease pencil layer dropdown called auto lock inactive layers. So that now when I select this new layer, all the other layers are locked. And with A, I can just select everything on this one layer. And by transforming it along the 3D cursor, which I can set here, I can just scale up this pixel canvas until it matches my original fill shape. More or less, good enough is good enough. This new canvas is now ready to be painted into. Let the smooth transitions begin. Now, I would like to create other pixel canvases, going in order of importance. So next up would maybe be the hair and the clothing. I would like to add smooth transitions in these areas, but I really don't need to capture a ton of geometry here. So on a new layer, I will fill in the hair. So because I'm using a fill material at 100% opacity, that was the alpha value earlier being at 1, I can layer strokes on top of one another without issue. So there's no pressure to fill a whole area with just one stroke. I can use multiple strokes if that's easier. Now I'll isolate this layer, lower the resolution, export, save, open the image, generate grease pencil, do lower resolution versions if it's too many points, if it's a good amount, I select my original, shift select my new, copy layer 2 selected, delete the new object, and in edit mode, scale up, and I'm good to go. Something else that's fun is to incorporate a gradient into this pixel canvas, so let's do that for the clothing. I'll create a new material, make it a gradient fill, and then I'll just fill in the clothing on a new layer. So gradients are a bit of a whole topic to themselves. Here is a video if you'd like to learn more. I'm just aiming to modify the settings so that the gradient within this stroke, it goes horizontally along my canvas, and then I'll modify the base color so that one is fully opaque and it transitions into full transparency. I'll give it a blend value of 1 so that the vertex color I use fully recolors it. Perfect, and now I will just repeat the process of creating the canvas, going even lower resolution for this part. So this kind of gradient of opacity, it can also be added to other pixel canvases. So this is by using the opacity tool in sculpt mode. So just hold control to lower the opacity. Though note that brushing that opacity back in or trying to add opacity with the strength brush, it does make the edges look a lot more jagged. And speaking of these darling jagged edges, I mentioned earlier not really seeing the pixelation when I rendered, but yep, that is some pixelation around these edges that I see. So this technique is, I think of it like a starter, creating a super smooth base that now I will go and render on top of. For me, it's not meant to be the entire piece. That is because of the jagged edges, because of the tiny amount of pixels that I'm able to use, and maybe most importantly, because I love smooth transitions. And I hate smooth transitions. This man with his flawless, poreless skin is giving me major uncanny vibes. This is not a man I want to meet. So it's not a look I personally enjoy. If I'm going to paint a person, I want to capture those pores and wrinkles and facial hair and freckles in some places. And then in other places, a smooth look is nice. I think it creates a nice contrast to have both of these styles, both smoothness and texture within the same piece. And that's why I said at the start of this video that my goal is to combine the benefits of a pixel canvas with the benefits of grease pencils, vector drawing tools. So from here, I'll be rendering on new layers on top of my base layers using all my usual tools and techniques. I'll be using my pencil brush to refine the sketch and to add in fine details, especially around the eyes. I'll be adding textures with my textured brushes, getting a bit of stubble, fabric texture, rough skin texture. I'll be making use of sculpt mode tools to refine and to nudge things, because you better believe I don't get the proportions right the first time around. Something else I might do, if I want to refine, like I mentioned, the edge of my pixel canvas, in edit mode, I use point select mode to select some vertices around the edges, and then I just delete these points if I want to shrink my pixel canvas down. So I've shared this in other videos, but I feel it's worth repeating here. When you're in edit mode, the pixel canvas, it makes some pretty gnarly geometry, and it is really hard to see what's going on. So a big part of my workflow is toggling show overlays on and off to show and hide the geometry. I use this so much that I've assigned it to a shortcut. My key of choice is D, and I use this constantly. Seeing the geometry is necessary for when I want to make selections in edit mode, but then once I have my selection, I'll toggle the overlays off so that I can actually see my art properly. So quite an unexpected benefit to using this method was how much it would have me consider the outline of the different elements of my piece. That's really not something that I consciously thought about previously when I would work. It's something that I heard was important in stuff like character design, to have a silhouette, an outline of a character that reads clearly and that is like distinctive from other characters. I remember seeing this example like used with the Simpsons characters, the whole family. If you just see their silhouette, you instantly know who everyone is in that silhouetted lineup. Doing this step for this new method and filling in the different objects really has me forced to consider the silhouettes that I see. And it's also caused me to be more intentional about how I design the silhouettes and how I like kind of fit the different elements into one another, almost like a puzzle piece. In the original sketch and in the original piece for this piece, I kind of just had elements overlapping one another without thinking too much about it. But now that is something that I've been doing, and I've been really enjoying the results. And now that I have all these objects filled in except for the snail, I'm noticing like it could kind of be placed a little bit better. And then R, I want to rotate it, and I'm just gonna squeeze it in a little bit more nicely now. If I turn off all of the lines and all I see are these outlines, I know exactly what I'm looking at. And I hope that I would know exactly what I was looking at, even if I wasn't the one who made this. But you know, that's clearly a dog. And those are clearly flowers. I would even go so far as to say sunflowers surrounding it. So that is so exciting. And drumroll, please, the final piece looks like. Now that's a man I wouldn't mind meeting. I don't know if I can find my first attempt at painting this. One second. I think it's somewhere here. Okay. Funnily enough, you want to talk about blending. This first one was actually painted with only a 100% opacity brush. Like I talked about, it's something I find fun to do from time to time. So how is that for full circle? The same piece made once with no blending and once with soft blending. I only realized this second time reading the stand that Stu is described as having dark hair. And at first I was like, I don't think that fits my idea of him. But now comparing blonde Stu and a dark-haired Stu, one is a clear winner. And it ain't blonde stew. I gotta remake Frannie with this method next. Okay. Let's conclude this. From when I first teased about this new technique to actually sharing this tutorial, I think a month has passed? 2 months? Sorry. The delay is because I kept learning new things about this method. So, two follow-up videos that I hope you'll be excited for are adding texture images as pixels, like how I completed the background of this piece, and how I use a pixel canvas for 3D grease pencil art. Thank you for your patience. I feel like I have a lot of different things that I have promised over the years and have not always delivered on. My brain gets very distracted by the like 5 different types of art that I make. Just know that nothing is abandoned. I have a big list of video and tutorial ideas, and I try and work on making new tutorials every week. So I am slowly chipping away at that tutorial idea list, and very rarely do I fully scrap an idea. It's coming, probably. All that to say, thank you for being here and for sticking with me ping-ponging between different topics and ideas. At least the program has stuck, though. That is fun. I appreciate you. If you want to follow me other places, Instagram is my poison of choice, the app I use most to share about my life. But I'm on the other ones too, sometimes. @SophieJantak. I'll see you soon. Take care. Bye.